Now the thing that I want to bring to your attention is the outside versus the inside. This is actually one of the most profound lessons of this ayah and this teaching to the Bedouins. The outside versus the inside. When you're praying, it's an act on the outside. When you're making wudu, it's an act on the outside. When you're reciting Quran, it's an act on the outside. These are things that you can do. These are behaviors that somebody else can see. If you're praying, I can tell that you're praying. But there's something else happening on the inside. Something else is happening on the inside. Somebody could be praying and their head is somewhere else. Somebody could be reciting Quran, they're not paying attention to what they're reciting. You understand? And Allah Azza wa Jal wants to see a transformation happen on the inside. وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ Iman hasn't entered into your hearts. Deep inside your heart, what are you thinking about? What's your goal in life? You know, why are you making your money? Why do you have your job? What are you going to do with your kids? What's your purpose? Why do you exist? You know, everybody has financial goals. You have this much money I want to make this year, this much I want in savings, this is where I want to buy the property, this is where I want to pay, this is how much payments I want to pay off, this is the car I want to get. You have these goals in your head. Where are your goals for Allah? That's the question I have to ask myself and you have to ask yourself. And those questions that you have about money and about the car and about school and about marriage, all of these questions that you have they take up space in your heart. You think about them all the time. When you're driving to work, you're thinking about them. When you're sitting home, you're thinking about them. Before you go to bed, you think about them. You know, meaning these things have a place in your heart. And Allah wants that place. He's not saying you get rid of those concerns. But where is Allah when it comes to that? What have I done for Allah? What have I done for Allah? People, you know, other religions, they are actually, this is a phenomenon in the world now, sociologists, especially people in the study of sociology of religion, they talk about this all the time. How generations of people that are Christians, Hindus, Buddhists, Jews, Muslims even, they're actually taking their religion very casually. It's this thing that was passed down from their parents. So most children that are being raised today and young adults, they're not religious. Because this was part of the culture of their parents. They don't see this as something you believe in. It's actually you see it as something as part of your culture. Just like, you know, you dress a certain way, it's a part of your culture. You eat certain kinds of food, it's part of your culture. Well, in our culture, we pray like this. In our culture, we have these rituals, we have this Eid and this stuff. It's just cultural stuff. But you know what? Our kids are picking up a new culture. They're not into biryani or baklava. They're into pizza. They want a burger, you know. They're different. So when they get rid of the old culture, for a lot of people in the world, they're getting rid of the old religion too. It's gone. Because all it was for them, all these kids, all the religion was a culture. It was just a set of practices on the outside. The religion had nothing to do with what was going on the inside. This is a very serious matter. Because you can lose entire generations of Muslims this way. This last year, I was in Mexico for just a day, in Mexico City. When I was there, one of the most densely populated cities in the entire world, 38 million people in one city. And I had my, you know, Zabiha restaurant app with me to look for some halal food because I had 6-7 hours to spend in the city with my wife. And we found two restaurants. And I went to one of them, a Moroccan restaurant. And I go, and the brother, Moroccan brother started this restaurant in 1972. He lives there in Mexico City. It's the only halal restaurant other than another one, a Pakistani restaurant, in the entire city. And we start chatting, and I was like, how do you do any business? Like, where are your customers? The entire city, they have Jumu'ah, maybe 200-300 people come for Jumu'ah. Okay, in the city of Mexico. Maybe two masjids combined, about 300 people. And one of the masjids is an old woman who became Muslim. She gave her house as a masjid. And that's where they hold Jumu'ah, right? And I said, is that it? Is that the only population of Muslims? He said, no. This is not the only population of Muslims. Actually, in the 70s and the 80s, there was, you know, Mexico opened up its borders because they were wanting to do a lot of development and engineering. So they opened up their borders and people from Syria, Jordan, you know, Bangladesh, people came from all over the Muslim world in hundreds of thousands. Hundreds of thousands. And they got engineering jobs and they got, you know, mechanical jobs and they got all these technical jobs that were working in this place. So I was like, did they all move back? Did they all move back after the 70s? No, they stayed. Their children are just not Muslim anymore. Their children are hundreds of thousands of people. And there's a couple of hundred people making Jumu'ah. This is very real. This is what happens when you only worry about work and you put food on the table, but you don't feed any hearts. You don't feed any hearts. Oh, we're Muslim, it's okay, alhamdulillah, what else is there? You know, you might be thinking about your career and your savings and your future, but let me tell you, one of those scariest things that you and I all have to think about is when we stand in front of Allah and we have to explain to Allah why the gift of La ilaha illallah that was given to you, that was given to me, the gift of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we could so easily have planted inside the hearts of our growing generation, we failed to do it because we were too busy with other things. Too busy with other things, so that two generations down the road, one generation down the road, there's nobody left to say La ilaha illallah. We're going to have to answer Allah for that one. فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدْ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. A long period passed, their hearts became hard, most of them are corrupt. That's why I want to share these ayat with you. This concern is real. Don't think, everybody thinks their own family is immune. Their family is safe. If anybody had a right to think that their family is safe, it would have been Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam could say, I raised my kids properly. And he did. His kid is so willing to submit to Allah, if'al ya abat if'al ma tu'mar. Do whatever you've been told. If Allah is telling you to cut my neck, cut it, ya, my father. It's okay. It's for the sake of Allah. فَلَمَّا أَسْلَمَا وَتَلَّهُ لِلْجَبِينَ. When they both submitted and he put his head down. And even that father, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he's so worried about his kids, he turns to Allah and says, وَاجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَا أَن نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. I'm shocked at these words. فَلَمْ يَقُلْ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ وَاجْنُبْنِي وَذُرِّيَتِي. وَاجْنُبْنِي وَذُرِّيَتِي أَن نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. لَا وَاجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَا أَن نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. He says to Allah, Ya Allah, keep me and keep my sons from worshipping idols. If he said dhurriyati, it would have meant keep me and my children and their grandchildren and their grandchildren and their grandchildren from worshipping idols. He's not even thinking that far. He's worried that himself and his own kids, even after they've come to Islam, Ya Allah, that does not mean we're safe. You're the only one who keeps us safe. Keep us from falling into the worship of idols. رَبِّ إِنَّهُنَّ أَضْلَلْنَا كَثِيرًا مِّنَ النَّاسِ. I'm shocked at that dua. I'm just absolutely shocked. That's the house that he built. That's the house that he built with his son. And he comes back and it's this thriving city where everybody worships Allah. And he's still worried that, Ya Allah, keep me and my children from worshipping idols. From falling into that. So now, the last thing I want to share with you, just about our kids, just to think about how Islam has to become a conscious thing, not just some practices. Not just we used to go to Jumu'ah. It can't. That's not going to be enough. I'm telling you now. You might be offended by what I'm saying, but that's okay. I'd rather you get offended and choose do something than not. For your own selves, for your own families. You know, this is our matter. Every child that falls into doubt, every child that cares more about video games than they care about Allah's book, you know, that's our loss. What I want to tell you about is idols. Ibrahim alayhi salam was worried about idols. We don't have that problem. There's no statue over here. There's no cross over here. We're not worried about our kids falling into the worship of idols. But you need to understand what idols are. What a sanam is. Every generation has its own idols. Every era has its own idols. Our idols today, by the way, an idol is something you worship, something your hopes are associated with, something you think about all the time, something that replaces the place of Allah in your heart. That's an idol. And very easily in our times, technology can become an idol. Very easily in our times, money can become somebody's idol that they worship. All they care about is money. All they care about is looks. All they care about is the gadget. You know? People are crying. People are crying because they can't make Hajj. And now you have people crying because they don't have the iPhone 6 Plus. You know? They're having a spiritual crisis because they don't have that video game. You know, I only have a PS3, I don't have a PS4. You know? They're crying, our kids are like bawling tears over this stuff. What have we done? We are creating idols for our children. They're innocent. What you put in front of them, they will become obsessed with. And then you cannot blame them for their obsession. I'm not saying you don't, you know, my kids play games, I play games with them. They do. But there's a balance that has to be achieved. Your job is not just there to just give your kids these luxuries in life and nothing else. Then these things will become their idol. This is all they will worship. This is all their life will amount to. You know, how many times I hear stories about teenage Muslim boys and girls. Teenage kids. I don't believe in God. How many, and I'm not talking about across the world, I'm talking about Texas. In Texas. I don't believe in God. Leave me alone, I just want to play my video games. Leave me alone. And those two things are not unrelated. That God got replaced with another God. That's what happened. This is when you're gaming 8 hours, 10 hours a day. You know? But we think, oh, well, Muslim, at least we go pray Jummah. At least we do something at Eid. We make some pakore at Eid. So we should be fine. This is وَلَمَّا يَدْخُلِ الْإِيمَانُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَإِنْ تُطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَا يَلِتْكُمْ مِنْ أَعْمَالِكُمْ شَيْئًا. If you continue to obey Allah and His Messenger, none of your deeds will be wasted away.